Well, if you like these videos, you're in luck, because I'm doing more taping. I'm doing a lot of taping because this is a week. This is an extremely important week, and I want to give as much possible to everyone to reiterate what is being said here. If you have good habits, great, keep them going. Let's talk a little bit about the habits we want to have here going into September. I've been saying my whole life to everybody who will listen, not many listen, don't get addicted to watching television or the media, engaging with the media. A little bit's okay, but always you should be able to disengage from it at a moment's notice without any trouble. Go cold turkey at any moment. So you cannot, don't be so, get reliant upon it. Don't let it be a habit. This is very important. I know I've preached this to some, they don't listen. And they think, well, sure, I enjoy it. Why should I stop? But if I need to stop, I can stop. Guess what? It's called a habit. And when you can you go cold turkey? You know what? In a day or two, you'll be right back at it. And people vastly underestimate the hold that habits have upon them. This is called spiritual pride. This is the heart of spiritual pride in pragmatic terms here in this world, is we don't understand the grip that habits have upon us. We think, well, I should be able to break that habit as easily. But it never turns out that way, does it? No, it doesn't. So, now, I watch a little baseball, a few sporting events on television, that's about it. So, for me, I'm not addicted to television or news or anything like that, no. So, if it comes time to stop, just stop cold turkey, that's it, not a problem. I don't experience any problem. I broke the habit. I never really had the habit that much, but let's just say, that's important to make sure you don't have this habit of being addicted to watching television, because this is how those who want to advance their narratives in the world, how they gain access to you, one of the major ways. And all of this stuff is designed to advance a certain narrative, and that narrative is not in your best interest. I can tell you that for sure. The content on television, for the most part, the shows, etc., are really designed by psychopaths that want to keep you sick, mentally sick, because they profit off of it. There's massive profits off of sickness in this world. It's the biggest industry in the world. And it is so blatant that, I cannot hardly understand why anyone would watch it, except they're addicted to it. Fear, they've got a habit. They have a habit. Once you break that habit, then you look back. The Holy Spirit had me do a year back in, I think, 1999 or 98, 99. There's sometime back then. I can't quite remember, but entire year, no media, no newspaper, no television, no radio. I mean, I just shut everything off. And then after a year, I took a little peek, a few peeks down there, and I was just stunned. I said, you mean, wow, my gosh, why would anyone want to watch this? It's horrible. So you most definitely want to break the habit of television, which is why I'm providing so many videos as an alternative to television and to all, Right, YouTube is a wonderful alternative to television, where you can choose your own videos, and most, a lot of them without commercials, and it's a wonderful service. Really, I'm grateful to YouTube for providing this. It's a great alternative. Now, a lot of us like to watch movies, television, video. We're very used to that, but stay away from the television. Stay away from the mainstream stuff, the stuff that is designed to keep you very mentally ill. All right. We're all quite mentally ill, actually. Everyone here. Some of us see a way out of it, okay? And others don't. They just feel this is just normal life, This is it. And they just label it normal. We're all very mentally ill. Anyone who thinks they're in a body, in a person, in a world is extremely mentally ill, actually. And they're suffering. So much of our culture, you might say almost all of it, is intentionally tailored and supported monetarily through all sorts of power from those who have a narrative to sell you so that they will profit off of your future. They want you to control your future so they will profit off of it. That's just, you know, business as usual in this world. That shouldn't surprise anyone that this is the case. And it absolutely still is the case. Nothing has changed in that way. So to subject yourself to that, it's going to pull you backwards. It's going to break your, it's going to halt your momentum towards peace of mind. Ultimately, where we're going towards is peace of mind. The great ones who have had peace of mind assure us that we can have this too. They absolutely assure us of this. So I take them at their word. I say, okay, I trust you. I believe you. It's just a matter I have to keep working at it and manage my success properly. Working at it really means managing our success, because as we take this goal, peace of mind is our goal, we're going to start advancing towards it. And when we're going to recognize this and say, hey, I'm making progress, I can actually do this. And it begins to dawn upon us that we're going to ultimately succeed at this. And then this just rocks our boat. You know, it's just like, you mean I'm leaving all this hideous hell, mental hell behind? Yes. And we're just, you know, we can hardly bear our happiness about this. You know, we're just overwhelmed by what great news this is. And this dawns upon us bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, because we need to get used to just how elated we are about this. So really, if you talk about a spiritual world, it's very pragmatic in that people are managing their success on the path. This is what we need to be taught. And this is what is, we're distracted from this. Very, very, very few even know about this, or and even less emphasize it. And therefore, many catch glimpses of success, but they don't know how to manage glimpses of peace of mind. They don't know how to manage their success. There's really no manuals, no one telling them how to do it. There, no teachers telling them how to do it. And they don't even realize that this is the key issue. And so they fall back. They fall back. This is very typical of this world. They say, well, it's impossible. Well, maybe someone else can do it, but I can't do it. Maybe I was just some sort of weird dream that, you know, didn't, you know, oddity. And they fall into sort of a skeptical mindset. Sour grapes, those who make it, they get sour grapes about it. And they just don't believe it because they didn't know how to manage their success. That's the crucial issue that has to be emphasized. Everything else falls in place along with that. So this is what I emphasize, you know, because again, as you manage your success, so will you experience what you're capable, ready to experience. Automatically that will happen. The wisdom will automatically come to you. But if you do not manage your success properly, you will backslide, you will get skeptical, the wheels will come off, you will lose your momentum, and you'll get frustrated, and on and on and on and on, and success will seem to be halted, you get frustrated. It's a bad scene. So as you manage your success, so you will experience greater success. As you play the piano, so you will hear the tune, is a favorite saying of a great teacher. As you play the instrument, so shall you hear the tune. So, meaning you have to manage, as you manage your success, this is what will lead you to more success. It will automatically come to you. They say when the student is ready, the teacher will appear. This is supposed to be an axiom that the great teachers have said. It's an axiom. Because you have to be able to handle the wow of that, the success of that. This means success is for sure guaranteed. I mean, when you eventually come across, you know, quote unquote, the teacher, the savior, the guru. I mean, there's a strong connection. It's no, you know, that teacher is not going to stop helping you until you have absolutely succeeded. There's no question about it. So this is an extreme wow, right? I mean, here in the West, we're not really even prepared for that hardly, right? So people spend their lives advancing, managing their success, managing. At some point, you know, they get an even greater boost, you know, a tremendous boost comes to them where, You know, they're told, hey, you know, your success is absolutely assured. That's a huge wow moment, isn't it? To know your success is absolutely assured, and to feel very strongly this way. So what I found along the path is that for a long time, you know, very intensely, really, I could my whole life, but you could say for, let's just say, 40 years, success after success after success after success, each one of them producing, you know, shaking me up, thinking, oh my gosh, is this really going to happen for me? I mean, it seems like it is. It really taxes our entire realm of expectations that we have. We have a vast realm of expectations, and it reshuffles our expectations. So the entire emphasis really has to be on managing our success, which you would say is full stop on the wow. Practically, it means practicing full stop on the wow. So in listening to these videos, this is a narrative. I do a narrative here for the purpose of bringing the listener and the viewer into the wow experience, helping them come into this wow experience, allow this wow experience to be there for you. The intensity, the feeling like I just, all my expectations, you know, have just, it's changed. The whole landscape has changed on me. And I just have to sit here for a while and just get used to it. It takes a little bit of patience. But every time you practice in this way and really give it everything you got, you know, the next day, if someone were to say the same thing that brought up this wow, you would say, hey, you know what? That doesn't really bother me too much. I mean, I don't really experience such a, you know, I say, oh yeah, I'm kind of used to that landscape. It's not such a trouble for me. And then you'll realize you've made tremendous progress. This is the entire secret of the path, is managing your success. This has to be emphasized. It is the core principle of it. Excuse me. But so much of our time, the spirituality of this world rests upon other stuff. Questions. Well, what about free will? Well, what about my destiny? Well, what about this? Well, what about that? What about that? You know, this is wrong emphasis. This is wrong emphasis. Questioning, questioning, questioning. This is totally wrong emphasis. Your emphasis needs to be on, how do I get to this wow experience today? I have to go big with my wow today. How do I do that? Ask the Holy Spirit for help. Ask the Holy Spirit for help. Tell the Holy Spirit today, Holy Spirit, I want to go, you know, bigger than I ever have today. And so I'm open to hearing a narrative, you know, to allowing you to orchestrate the day in such a way that I get to this really big wow. And let this be our basic faith. Ask the Holy Spirit, orchestrate everything about my experiencing, without any exception, which will bring about an even bigger wow experience than I've ever had before. So challenge yourself in this way. And when we look at it this way, the spiritual path is very simple. It really is. And whatever questions anyone has, the answers will come when one is ready to experience the wow of it. Because if these answers are so important, you have questions about it, I really want to get the answer to this question. Well, when the answer comes, you must then just be absolutely overjoyed and elated, over the moon, you know, to get the answer. Are you ready to get the answer? Is the real question. When someone asks a question, are you actually ready for the answer? Are you ready to manage your success, extreme success? And the answer is no. What they do is they just ask another question. That's not the spiritual path at all. And, you know, we need to get very focused on what it's really about. So the more you manage your success, the more great breakthroughs you will have. And it seems like these questions that used to be important to you, but not even that important, because you realize, I can do way better than that. I can do way better than that. I'm way past even worrying about that or being concerned about it. I'm going to be, you know, truly liberated. Truly liberated. I'll have the answer to the most important question. The question, having answered that, nothing else remains really to be answered. So we need to do a reset, you know, a spiritual reset. And everyone kind of needs to say, okay, you know, let's turn to doing it the right way now. Let's do it the right way. No matter where we what have we done before, let's do it the right way. And let us put our focus, emphasis, to the exclusion of much else, okay, to the exclusion of a lot of stuff. We're excluding it. We're putting our emphasis on managing our success. And this automatically gives us a positive outlook because it does tacitly imply here that there will be great success to manage, doesn't it? Absolutely it does. And there will be. And there will be. So many spiritual seekers are just spiritual seekers. They're not on the path. They're just seeking to be spiritual. They're trying to spiritualize the ego. Yeah, they have a longing. But they have a longing for stability, peace of mind. But the way they're doing it is they think that to stabilize the ego, make the ego permanent. And then never be frightened by stopping pretense, because they'll have a wrong idea of causation of it and won't look in the right place for it. And so, you know, the pretense will be permanent, they think. And this is how to find happiness. So they're not really on the spiritual path because they're not focusing on managing their success. So when I was young in school, people, you know, most of the teachers ask, okay, everyone's going to say, what am I going to be like? What's my goal in life? You know, and I couldn't say because I didn't want to be mocked, you know, but for me, it was to be a saint. Absolutely. Which is to find peace of mind. No question about it. And I was absolutely sure I was going to do so. So for me, I said, I'm just going to have to manage my success. It's going to happen, so I better prepare for it. I better get ready for it. So this gave me a positive, you know, positive outlook towards it. And I say, well, I'm certainly going to pass a lot of milestones along the way. So what's going to happen when I pass a milestone? Well, I began passing many milestones. I says, wow, 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 wow. You know, as soon as you get on the path, you're way more farther along than almost anybody on the planet. Just starting the path, because very few even start the path on this planet. So this is a huge wow that takes quite a bit of getting used to. Because, you know, you think, my gosh, the whole world is venerating these scientists and these statespeople and these rule, you know, these philosophers and all this kind of stuff. And you realize, I'm way past that. I'm way past that. Just by starting on the path, just by saying, I'm going to manage my success, you're already way past that. And so this is like a stunning development for you, a stunning development. As you go along, you may be contacted by others who are the great activists of spiritual, of peace of mind, you know, true spiritual mental health, the great advocates of peace of mind. You may come in contact with them in subtle ways. They may say, hey, I like what you're doing. I'm an activist too. Welcome to the club. Then if I can help you, let me know. You know, there's this quote-unquote fraternity of you know, to use a gender, non-gender specific term, I'll just use the, you know, general term of fraternity, meaning ones who have a like-mindedness, you know, and a similar path, a similar goal, etc. And of course they're going to say, hey, I love what you're doing. This is great. You know, you're going to help this goal out. We have a common goal here. Keep in mind the great teachers have a common goal. They share a common goal. And so if you are working to help them out, they're going to be very appreciative of that. Now, sometimes I wish they'd show their appreciation in more direct ways. It's hard to determine, how they're helping, because we often seem lost at sea. That's to say the least of it. I mean, but it has to do with the wow factor. If they were more direct in their help, the wow might overwhelm us, and we'd go searching for help from the ego, and the ego say, well, hey, I know, don't worry, I know how to spiritualize, your life, and I got a better way for stability, make the ego permanent, be permanently convinced that there's a mortal mind causing this situation here, and it's not just spirit pretending to be it, so the ego will, lead you into self-deception, and you may feel as though you're being stabilized, but you're just delaying, then you've kind of, backsliding along the path. So you pass milestones, more and more, and just every milestone you pass, it shakes you up. Because you say, hey, this kind of milestone is this is very, very super significant. This is what you get to when you're really, really, really succeeding. And of course that is going to rock your world, rock everything. It just... am I really sick? Little old me, am I really succeeding? Not me with all my troubles and problems. I mean, that's not possible, is it? This is almost sort of incredulity, that dawns upon you. Can I really believe? And then you have to, the spiritual path is you have to accept your success. This is the price you pay. The price you pay for taking the spiritual path is success. This is the price you must pay. So, as success comes upon you, as it will, you just have to say, this is the price I gotta pay, I gotta pay this price. It's very stressful. So when miraculous situations happen for you, this is the price I have to pay. Look at it that way. There's a very pragmatic way of looking at it that will help stabilize you. You just say, there you go again, that's the price I gotta pay. For example, Ram Maharshi showing up in your dreams, which has been happening to me a lot, and there's also been comments about it happening to others here. So this is the price you have to pay for success. I mean, this is a great success. And we just got to say, wow, this is the price I have to pay. Because that's quite stunning. Now, he's very circumspect, as they are, and yet still... when deep down you say, realize, wow, little old me, are you kidding me? I mean, I have to live up to this? I mean, wow, this is just the price I've got to pay. So if you look at it that way, I can just feel how I feel much more stable and poised looking at it this way. And I wish I had known that a long time ago. But unfortunately, there was no direct teaching like this available that I could ever find that just, right up front with no apology or bones about it said, look, managing your success is where it's all at. This is where the emphasis is. There's too much philosophy and talk about this and this and, spiritual. That's ancillary to the issue of managing your success, because what good is it if you get insight of this if you can't handle the shock of it? It's just going to cause you to backslide, and you will get to that automatically. The better you are at managing your wow, you automatically get to that. It's all there. It's not like you have to give birth to truth. The truth is already true. We're already abiding as the self. Actually, we're just distracted from this, looking elsewhere. Like we say, oh, where are we abiding as the self? I want to see this. Oh, I really want to see this, I can't wait to find this. Where's the self? Where's the abidance? I got to find this. We're in fact, we are the ones that we're searching for. We're already abiding in it. But as long as we're searching for it elsewhere, we don't realize it. So, a great teacher appearing to someone, it means that you've done a lot of, you're very, very skillful in managing your success on the path. That's what it means. And this is to be highly respected, for those on the path, this is something that they, you know, highly respect, because, you know, it's the skills that they need to become expert at too, and it just shows them it's possible. And so it's a great boost to everyone on the spiritual path. Any success on the spiritual path, we all delight in. We all delight in it, you know, because this helps reinforce that we can do it too. So as we say, it's all good. It's all good. I rejoice in anyone's success on the path. I absolutely rejoice in it. Because again, this says, look, it is possible to get these management skills. It is possible to manage my success, because success would not come if I weren't, you know, very skilled in managing it. Now, some, I have to say, sometimes it happens that people get glimpses of success. They make a big push, but they're not expert at managing their success. And so what they become is experts in hiding the fact that they've backslid away from it. And they become that way, you know, and the ego advises them to be like that. So, oh, you got a glimpse into reality, you see, wonderful, wonderful. The ego says, okay, but you know, but now you don't have it. Well, don't let anybody know that, you know, you just, you know, and just become an expert in hiding the fact that you're not an expert in managing your success, that you backslid. And this does happen quite a bit, actually, in the world. But the funny thing is, you might see somebody who's an expert at managing their success, who's still very humble, without denigrating themselves. I mean, they will admit, like I admit, that I'm, you know, I'm having a great deal of success in passing milestones. This is true. And I'm getting better and better and better at managing my success, and I'm very good at it. But I'm still very humble, realizing the next wow is just around the bend, you know. And this wow will definitely humble me, no question about it. So I stay in this very humble mode of realization, the next thing's going to rock my boat big time. So I expect my boat to be rocked, and I expect to have to deal with this very skillfully. So, but the funny thing is those who are, you know, who are skillful at managing their success, what might be way more advanced than those who, some teachers in the world who are hiding their, you know, hiding that they've backslid, you know, very, very artfully. We might be way, way more advanced than them, and yet it doesn't seem that way, because we're not really coming out and saying we definitely are enlightened, we're enlightened teacher and all this kind of stuff. We're saying, no, I'm still on the path. You know, I'm just helping others on the path by, you know, encouraging them to manage their success. But we might be actually way more advanced than they are, way further along. But the world doesn't know it, doesn't see it that way at all. And, you know, and it's frustrating. It's frustrating, you know, when you see those jump into the, you know, the stage, and you say, wow, you know, it's, you know, and you realize, wow, they don't know what they're talking about, really, not really, because they're not emphasizing managing your success on the path. You know, it's they might talk a good game, but they're not emphasizing what's right. They're unaware of it. They're ignorant of it, because they themselves didn't do it. They had some sort of momentary breakthrough, which can happen to anybody. Absolutely. And it does. But that's not the end all and be all at all. Not at all. You know, many people have a peak experience. They make a career out of that peak experience. It's very, very common. You get a bunch of credentials to make sure that you feel they're an authority figure. And don't dare say, hey, wait a minute, the emperor or empress has no clothes here. Wait a minute, I mean, really, are you really enlightened? Or did you have some peak experience, you know? Enlightened means you're abiding. You're abiding in it. That's the only enlightenment there is. Okay. Glimpses, holy instance, moments of miracles, glimpses, etc. You know, those are great. We need those. But that's not the same thing as abidance. Not at all. Not even remotely the same. Abidance is the goal and the difficulty of getting to that, which is what we're aiming at here. Having gone past many, 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 many super significant milestones, still the big fish is out there, right? We've landed so many little fish and some bigger ones, but the big one still there, out there. Now, I've had it on the line before, but it slipped the hook. It slipped the hook, you know. It's of course my own fault. I basically said, hey, get off the hook. You know, I'm not quite ready for this. And so it obliged. It obliged. So we don't need to take a backseat to anyone here. I don't feel I need to take a backseat to anyone. I know how to manage success on the spiritual path. There's no question about that. I have proven that and proven it and proven it over and over and over. The fact that I haven't reached the ultimate goal doesn't contradict, you know, the successful in managing a spiritual path. Not at all. Not in the slightest bit. So I understand my place is that certainly I have value in understanding what needs to be emphasized and how to manage success on the spiritual path. And at the same time, I understand there's still some more success to come. And until that arrives, you know, I'm not enlightened. No, absolutely not. Not yet. I still have to land that big fish and not let it slip off the hook and, you know, say, hey, let's hang out together here. Absolutely. But, you know, I won't put up with anyone, you know, trying to take an authoritative position over me or anything like that. No, that's just not going to happen at all. Not the place where I'm at. Not at all. I have genuine insight into the entire situation, especially how to manage the path, which is all important. That trumps everything. It really trumps everything. Except abidance. Actual abidance. It, you know, it doesn't trump that. Okay, let's put it that way. That's the ultimate sign of one who truly learned how to manage their success on the spiritual path and knows what it's all about. No question about it. But just below that are those who have truly learned also how to manage success, and they're, you know, using that. They haven't quite yet arrived at abidance. In what? You know, well, we can't say, can we? Not really. Neither this nor that. You know, neither this nor that. But you could say peace of mind. Absolute, stable, calm, peaceful, peace of mind. Yeah. So I know my business. I know what I'm engaged in. I know through massive struggle, gradually identifying, you know, what's the real trouble. I've been trying to find an overall common trouble because I see we're not getting there in this world, okay? And we're easily distracted. And so I want to find that which truly will work. So I really put myself through this overall examination of the whole situation, and in doing so, sorted through, looked at this, and I found out there is this common denominator of all importance, which is managing your success. You can't reduce it any further than that. You absolutely cannot. This is the ultimate touchstone. This is the area that we have to emphasize, and we have to become experts at it. You know, it's the tortoise and the hare sort of thing. I'm telling you, it's the tortoise that wins the race. Okay? And the tortoise seems to be going slow, you know, and the hare is, you know, is going real fast, but what happens to the hare? You know, gets lazy, then it retreats, jumps some other direction. And says, where are you going? Whereas the tortoise is relentless towards the goal. Why the tortoise has to go slow, it's having so much success, You know, it's just like, wow, I'm really getting there. Oh, another step closer. I really have the right direction. You know, I know I'm getting closer. Every step I take, I'm getting closer. I'm going to make it. And this causes this constant wow in the tortoise, right? And therefore, the tortoise seems to be going slower, and yet it's relentless. And its direction remains true. Should I put up this block? Or just let the light come in? Maybe I just let the light come in. What the heck, you know? So, there you go. Well, it's still coming through. That's okay. Let it all come through. Let all the light come through. So the tortoise wins, period. The tortoise wins. And so I am absolutely adamant about that. Through a lifetime of extremely intense effort is the way of the tortoise wins. The hare never gets there. The hare talks a great game, but never gets there. We want to get there. The path, the way of the tortoise wins. That's the winning strategy. And so I insist upon it. Absolutely insist upon it. And the capacity to sit quietly, silently, in the wow, not in your intellect, not in the thoughts and thinking, but just in this wow, this one reaction, which is really, is the tortoise saying, wow, I'm really getting there. I just passed this milestone. I just see something very important. Wow. You know, you slow down. You be the tortoise. You're not in a hurry at this point. The wow is there. And you get used to it. And it's pretty much the same feeling. The wow, it's always been the same feeling. It's this mixture of elation and trepidation. As the tortoise moves forward, the tortoise says, oh my gosh, you know, I'm leaving, you know, misery behind. I'm leaving ignorance behind. I'll never be the same. I just took a further step. And if I just settle into the wow, I know I'll never backslide from this. I'm never going back to the ignorance that I had before. I'm never going back to it. Now, if you're fortunate enough, when you're fortunate enough to have the help of a great teacher in some way that's really profound, you'll realize I will never, ever be without this kind of help again, ever. You know, how big of a wow is that? I'll never be alone again as far as spiritual. I'll never feel alone. I know that there's someone who has my back, and it will always be this way. They won't let me backslide, you know? They'll have my back. Every step, you know, you know, extremely profound. And of course, most are not, you know, ready for that. And so they might ridicule it, they might poo-poo it, they might not pay attention. Well, that's why they're not ready for it yet. You have to advance gradually, and respect the advancement that those have made who do have these wonderful experiences, you know, because that assures, that shows you what's to come for you too. You can get there also. And we're after reassurance, absolutely after reassurance, as we walk together in the wow, like the tortoise, kind of seemingly slow. We spend a lot of time. Someone will laugh at you and spend 2.5 hours watching this video. How crazy, you know. I mean, I just watched this 3-minute shorty video, you know, of you know, instant enlightenment, you know, what's the big deal, you know. Yeah, I got it. You know, people, you'll explain it to them. You can explain, I'm doing this. Oh, okay, I got it. Like that, I got it. That's the hair. So got what? Did you get the skills of managing your success on the path? Is that what you got? No, they don't even know such a thing exists. It never would occur to them. This is what you have to get. This is what we have to get. is the skills of managing it. So you put in the time. You put in the time. Those who are putting in the time managing the well, those are going to be the successful ones. If you are among those who are doing that, you can know that you're going to succeed. You will succeed. This is the way. This is how you do it. You put in the time, like the tortoise, you allow yourself to slow down in the wow, full stop in the wow. And it seems like a slowdown, doesn't it? And you just do that until you feel ready to move forward again. But you spend a lot of time at it. You might watch a 2.5 hour video, 2.5 hours of intense progress like this. You know, that is extraordinarily helpful. And as you add those hours up, and as you add this practice up, you will realize that you're really getting there. You are really getting there. Meanwhile, the hares, the ones, they're still jumping around, not really knowing, still doing their hare thing, saying, you don't need to spend all that time, it's ridiculous. I just got another video, prosperity, enlightenment, or something. And, I just did this. And unfortunately, this is how it goes with them. This is just, how it goes here. It's extremely obvious. So we can, if we make a prayer, we can say, hey, spiritual peace of mind activists, be ferociously intent on preventing any backsliding in us whatsoever. Those who are on the path, be ferocious advocates of no backsliding. Be absolutely dynamic, ferocious advocates of it. Watch our backs with absolute, intense intention and determination. So make a prayer like that. Do not let us backslide. Period. This is in your hands, Those who are still in the past still do have the potential to backslide. Okay? This is our humility. We absolutely still have that potential. Every day. We have this potential. Every day I have to battle this. We battle it, don't we? Every day we battle it. Yet those who have finished, they don't battle it. They're beyond the battle now. They're beyond the battlefield. There's no more battlefield for them. And yet their goal is for all of us to be off the battlefield forever. So they're intense advocates of success, and so we align with it. We accept your great protection of us right now, your adamant protection of us from all, however you got, whatever path, whatever labels it was used for your path to get off the battlefield forever. It doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is you're off the battlefield forever. That's all that matters. So I call upon all who are permanently free from the battlefield to use the utmost vigilance and be ferociously vigilant, adamantly vigilant, and guard against any and all backsliding on our parts. And do not let even one little exception creep in. Do not allow any exception to creep in to this. This is what I mean by total vigilance. Be totally vigilant without any exception. And this is reaching out. This is how we reach out to these great ones who have escaped the battlefield, never to return to it. This is how we reach out to them. and they reach out to us. And this is how we establish a connection with them. Because when they help us, they say, well, you did call for me, my help, right? And I say, absolutely, I did. And I've been expecting it, which is a wow thing. So we get over the wow, wow, we really called upon them. Wow, we really expect the help. We're going to get it. We're going to get the help that we call for. See, I've never called for help in this adamant a fashion before. So that's a big wow. Because it means we're going to get that help. Because this is how you reach out. Because this is what they're here for. This is what they help us for. They prevent us from backsliding. They guard against it. They're saying, we will not allow any exception to creep in to cause your backsliding. No backsliding, therefore, we're not going to allow any means whatsoever to backslide. For us, it's all the same. They can see it that way. We still don't quite see it that way. They're not fooled. They see similarity where there's similarity and differences where there are differences. We are still a little fuzzy about that. Now, I point out in the Catholic Church where bringing light is necessary, I do, and also where praising it is called for, I absolutely do that too, and they are to be praised for the appealing to the saints, okay, appealing to the whole body of saints, apostles, Jesus, etc. And the body, the whole body of Christ, as they call it, they appeal to help in preventing backsliding, warding off that which is designed to pull us down off the path, away from, you know, into the falsity of trying to spiritualize mortal mind and trying to cement delay as permanent. They do make those appeals in prayers. And this is very good. This is very, very good. Because it's wide, it's ecumenical, it means Catholic, means universal. Now, I go further than that, but because I don't put any denominational stipulations on anyone. If you are permanently off the battlefield, you're good enough for me. Period. Makes absolutely no difference to me, you know, through which religious tradition you succeeded or how you succeeded or whatever. If you're permanently off the battlefield, you are good enough for me, period. So I appeal to all of those. I don't need to, you know, make it provincial at all. I don't need to appeal just to the Christian, you know, Catholic saints. I certainly do appeal to them, as well as all. Equally, I appeal to everyone without any stipulation whatsoever. All those who are permanently off the battlefield, never to return to it, I appeal to you for your utmost vigilance right now. For all those on the spiritual path, to guard against any and all backsliding to the utmost of your will. And to remain vigilant in this. Ceaselessly vigilant in this. And does anyone really think that if somebody, for instance, was able to escape the battlefield through like some tradition, for instance, like Buddhism, does anyone really think and believe that somehow in making this appeal they're going to say, well, are you a Buddhist? Oh, you're not a confirmed Buddhist? Well, then I can't answer your appeal. Sorry. Does anyone really believe that in the slightest bit? It's so ridiculous that you have to laugh at it. Do you think, you know, reality is some provincial realm where there's all these sectarian spiritual politics taking place, etc.? completely absurd. I mean, it is, in these videos, I don't make any, in my spirit, I don't make any differentiation about who's watching them from any background, any tradition whatsoever. They're all put out there for the whole world to watch, and I welcome anyone and everyone to watch the videos and to prosper from the advice. It's all about getting off that battlefield. It's all about abidance and the perfect peace that is God. And it's all about managing your success along the spiritual path, how whatever you want to term, however you want to refer to God, the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, however you want to refer, the various reference points you want to make, doesn't matter, because it's all about managing your success, and the wow factor will arise for you exactly the same as arises for anybody else, whether you're on a Christian path, a Buddhist path, a Hindu path, whatever else, all other paths, whatever you're on, the wow factor is the same. It's the same. You're going towards absolute peace of mind, realizing that it's absolutely permanent and eternal life, and as you advance toward it, you're going to have this wow reaction within you. No question about it. So I do say that there may not be a universal theology, but there is a universal way to manage your success, which is you have to do it. It's inescapable. It's the common denominator to all paths and traditions. Common denominator is you have to manage your success. So I feel like a totally ecumenical, advisor here and encourager. I may pull examples from one tradition or another, but I'm not favoring this or that. I'm saying, it's managing your success, full stop, and the wow, which is of ultimate importance to you and to everyone. Someone might say, well, I just did a fast, I just did a, 3-day retreat meditation, I'm so high, and blah, blah, blah. Oh, great, but how are you managing the success that this has brought you? What are your skills in doing that? I mean, can you do another 3-day retreat tomorrow, starting tomorrow? Oh, no, man, this is enough for the year, I'm so spiritualized, this is amazing, Well, that's the hair, isn't it? Maybe next year they go to another retreat. That's not the spiritual path. The ego makes mincemeat of that. You end up trying to spiritualize your life, immortal life, instead of arriving in abidance, in this perfect peace of mind. You don't arrive there. How do you gain success in managing your success? By continually working at it is how you get it. It's an art. There's an art to it. I can talk about it, but it's an art. It's not a science. It cannot be didactically taught in some university program, so this is what you, okay, I got it, it's not like that. You have to experience success. You have to experience the wow. Now, those going to retreats have the opportunity to gain experience, and in some ways they will. It'll be forced upon them. So it's not a bad thing, okay? I'm not saying spiritual retreats are a bad thing. I'm saying that they're not necessarily a good thing either. it can go either way. It can go either way. Give the benefit of the doubt in that, whatever success you have, well, you're confronted by the success then. But what happens is a lot of times people turn to the ego for help with the success. Say, wow, I don't know what to do about this ego. Help me. And the ego says, of course I'll help you. It's very clever at this. And the ego says, don't worry, I'll manage your success for you. I know how to do it. I know how to do that. I know what you really want. You want to make delay permanent. You want to make sure that there's this, you believe that this causative agent of causal mind, of mortal mind is causing, you know, all of this, or it's happening to mortal mind, you know, but it's not spirit that's pretending all this. Of course not. No, that's crazy. So you want to be sure that you don't see it that way. Then that's what you really want, the ego will say. So the ego thinks it knows what you really want. So when you turn it over to the ego, the ego's going to say, oh, great, you've turned it over to the master here, you know. Yeah, the ego thinks it's the master of knowing what you want and how to advise you at that. And, of course, it will turn you in the wrong direction. And will give you some perks like spiritualizing your life, pretending to be spiritualized in some way, but you're no longer on the path. I mean, you've backslid on the path. Backslid. So the potential for, you know, those retreats, you know, retreats should really be training people to manage their success. And some of them, maybe they are. I'm not an expert, you know, on all retreats by any means. You know, some of them probably are. You know, do help out with this. And this is, you know, the right emphasis. There should be, but the primary emphasis is on managing your success. And as you hear this and learn to sit very quietly and commit to no action, both outer and inner, this is how you really generate momentum, because then the success will automatically dawn upon you. And to their credit, you know, some go that way, you know. It may seem to us, you know, may seem many backwards, but the ability to sit quietly and still and give up any effort towards, but they don't explain it that well, in my opinion. You know, there are traditions that have some very, you know, have some solid groundwork to it, but I feel that they're deficient in being upfront about it and explaining it very clearly, that, you know, this is why, you know, we're doing it this way. Because this is what essential, this is the absolute essential that you will have your entire path, is to sit quietly, to sit still, to sit quietly, be committed to no action externally or internally. Okay, be committed to that and practice that. That is the meditation. I mean, just being acknowledging your commitment and the willingness to be committed to that and getting proficient at it gradually, you know, this is the solid foundation. Now, and we're all to blame. I mean, I could say, you know, in looking back in hindsight, I can say, well, you know, I thought, like, hey, maybe I could skip that, and I need to, you know, talk about some higher truths and all this kind of stuff, and so that caused me a lot of problems. But that's pretty much par for the course, because who was really willing to be so humble to just start out just sitting quietly and practicing this way? It takes a great deal of humility, because most people say, well, I can do better than that, you know. If I need to, I can sit still and quiet if I really need to, but I'm too busy getting answers, you know. I'm too busy getting answers. So we all struggle with this. We all struggle with this. And it's sitting quietly, committed to no action, committed to it with an intense purpose. It's not just kind of being like, you know, hey, I'm just sort of got sort of a laid back personality, so it's kind of easy for me just to hang out. That's not what it is at all. In fact, you may have a fiery personality, and be able to do this really, really, really great. You know, I have a very fiery personality. Yeah, I love heat. We're in a heat wave now. I love it. I said, oh, if it was only like this all the time. Being a Leo, a late Leo, sort of, you know, perfect fire sign, very fiery. And yet, you know, I've been able to excel at this because you do need this fiery intention, you know, that nothing is going to break my commitment to this. Be very vigilant and determined. It's not kind of like one of these la-di-da, you know, new age spiritualized types that, you know, yeah, I want to sit and do some yoga and relax. I'm so spiritual. It's not that at all. It's not that at all. It's just saying, you know what? you know, I'm ready for a baptism by fire here. I'm not going to react by any action externally or internally at all. I'm going to go full stop in the wow. No matter what success comes upon me, I am not going to fail here. I am going to succeed at this. You know, see, this is tremendous intent, determination, and fieriness. Say, I'm going to do this, you know. I'm not going to fail. This is, you know, the best attitude to have. The best attitude. Because then, you know, you're ready for success to dawn upon you. You're ready to see something. You're ready to realize something very heavy. They'll just rock your boat severely. And you're ready to hang on. You know, you say, I'll ride out this storm. I'm ready to ride out this storm. Whatever the storm is, I'm going to ride it out. This is the attitude to take towards spiritual practice. Not like I'm just doing some stress reduction. In fact, this practice is stressful. It's stressful. I'm not trying to just, you know, keep myself looking young and sweet, you know, to old age by doing stress reduction practices so I'm made attractive for, you know, into late age, you know, whatever. You know, no, this is stressing me out. It's aging me, so to speak. But actually, in another way, it's not. The willingness to go through the fire ultimately brings the great benefit of peace of mind. So it is stressful. Because, you know, your boat is going to get rocked when you're ready for it, when you're ready and willing. Wow, this just really did happen. We don't say, did this really happen? No, we say, yeah, this really did happen. I really did experience this. This really is intense. This really completely shifts my perspective. The whole landscape has just shifted. I mean, this really has happened. And now I'm just going to hold on. I'm just going to hold on to this. So I'm an adamant proponent of this. And, you know, this gets noticed somehow. Some way, I don't know how, it gets noticed, you know, to be an adamant proponent of this. And more than that, I've reached out. I reach out to all those who have permanently left the battlefield. I say, make sure that we don't get attracted back to the battlefield, okay? If we try to backslide, you're right there saying, no, 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 no. No backsliding. And you're there every step convincing us, no, don't, you're not going to backslide. I'm not going to let you. You know, we reach out to that. We celebrate the help. However it comes, we make no differentiation. We accept it all. We accept it all. No backsliding. Now, I mean, the world hasn't seen my fieriness really hardly at all. You get a little bit of it here in the videos. But the course of the spiritual path, you're so embattled by the struggle to get off that battlefield, you know, managing. You're so immersed in the managing of it that, you know, you can't really shine. You can't really shine. No, not all are fiery. Some are cool, which is also very good. They can express this wonderful coolness, as it were. That's great too. You know, whatever your personality, whatever your characteristic is, there's a great side to it that will express itself in a very helpful way. I tend to be very fiery and very adamant. You know, the lion roars. Okay, that's what the lion does. A lion roars. Hard to roar in this world. Very difficult to roar. I'm trying. But also, lions are usually very, very good natured and very slow to, you know, as far as being irritated. No, no, very difficult because, you know, because they don't, you know, this is the way they kind of relax and say, hey, I don't need to react to that. I'm a lion. I don't need to react to that. I'm not gonna let that bother me. But the lion will protect from backsliding, you know, if need be. Absolutely. Is a friendly lion, but not a cowardly lion. Let's put it that way. Very friendly, but not cowardly. And, you know, it's very important to recognize this. But those who can come on real strong, oftentimes they underplay it a great deal. Underplay it, you know. They try not to come on too strong, but sometimes you do need to come on strong. There's a time for it. Just like this heat spell is going to come on strong. Well, great. Bring it on. And it's important to recognize that this is super important. This is the most serious business there is in the world. This is our true business in the world. And so if we're not serious about this, then we're not serious about anything, plain and simple. This is our true responsibility, our true business is to get off that battlefield. And so of course we take this with the utmost seriousness. This is our responsibility here. Call us what you want. Some people call us humans, whatever that means. We're really spirit just pretending to not be what we really are. But whatever you call us, you know, this is our responsibility. Have to gently set the pretense off to the side here. Let's gently set it off the side. Let's not attack it. Let's not get rid of it entirely. Let's gently set it off to the side and let it be transformed by the Holy Spirit into a beautiful reminder of honoring our creativity. You know, that's what our goal is. That's what we must do. And that ultimately eventuates in we've given up all pretending as if it never happened. You know, we're completely finished with pretending, most likely never to ever return to it. Ultimately, you see, ultimately, that's ultimately what happens, but we're not interested in that ultimate goal. We're interested in what, for us, is an ultimate goal here, is that to gently set aside our pretending, let the Holy Spirit transform it in such a way as that it beautifully honors our creativity, what we put into it. Okay, but that's as far as it goes. And we're abiding in this, in a peace of mind. So we're getting, you know, I'm trying to be, you know, more and more adamant, because the times require it. There's a power play coming up. There's a lot of different narratives in the world that are vying for supremacy right now. A narrative is something, a narrative is basically what we want the future to be like. How do we want the future to be like? And our narrative is, you know, talking it up, campaigning for it, saying, hey guys, you know, this is what you really want. If you want a future like this, right, this is what's really good for you. This is how we get there. We need to do this and this and this. And, you know, we market it, etc. It's a narrative. And there are all sorts of different narratives vying for control of the future of this planet. What we believe, how we act, how we structure our life. This is a narrative. This is, we're telling ourselves this is what we need to do. So there's many different narratives right now vying for control over the future of this planet. In the situation we're in right now, September 2015, we're at a point where a shift is going to happen in some direction. No matter what, we reach the tipping point. So all these different narratives realize this, that we've reached a tipping point. And so they're in a frantic mode right now of trying to seize the opportunity, seize the moment, carpe diem, seize the day, and come out as winners. And they all think that they can win. They all think that they're going to be winners. All the chips are on the table right now. So they're desperate to win right now, for their narrative to crush the others and to carry the day, and therefore their future will be the way they want it to be. They believe this is the future that will make me happy, give me what I really want, so I want the future to be like this. Well, there's all sorts of competing narratives right now, and they're all quite strong. And so there is an intense power struggle taking place in the world right now, very intense. And this power struggle, the world is going to get caught up in this power struggle most likely. And the tipping point is likely to come in September where, you know, they take the gloves off, you know, they take their gloves off and saying, we're going for it. And if, you know, just one does that, if just one of these narratives decides we're going to go and try to grab it, then the others are also going to leap in and try to grab it too. So it seems like we have peace now in the world, but this peace is very fragile. Because all it takes is just one of these narratives to try to seize control. And the others will say, hey, wait a minute, not so fast. And they're going to jump in and try to seize control for themselves. And then you have a free-for-all. And then you have a severe power struggle taking place in the world. And all bets are off. Because in a power struggle, there is no conscience. They have no conscience at all. They'll do anything and everything, including false flags, you name it, to win. Because they say, well, if we win, we get to control the narrative, right? So we'll say, well, we did nothing wrong. That's the narrative. We did nothing wrong. Everything we did was great. We're the good ones. The others were the bad ones. You know, it was divinely ordained that we will win, and that's all there is to it. So they don't really care once the power struggle is underway, you know, about playing fair at all, actually. And don't expect them to play fair in the slightest bit. So this autumn is it seems to be the tipping point. I think most people would agree with this, that some the world is going to change into some narrative at this point. There's no question about it. It's a only question is who's going to be controlling this narrative. This is the question we have. Whose narrative is going to be the controlling one, as it were. The dominant narrative that you know, who's going to dominate. Now, of course, the narrative is saying, well, we all need to get along and work together, but that's just posturing, that's diplomatic posturing, etc. You know, we everyone, you know, whether we know it or not, has some expectation of the future and how they want it to be. And we want it to go that way. We want it to go that way. I mean, my narrative is that I want us to focus on right spiritual practice, of managing our success on the spiritual path. That's my narrative. That's how I want the world to be. I want that to be our number one priority. And I want the other narratives to basically, you know, off to the peripheral, very peripheral. One moment, please. Yeah. Okay, I'm still taping, okay?
Coming?
Not right now, okay? It's set up, you know. I want this is my narrative. This is what I want. I want the other stuff to be, you know, not have any juice to it. I don't want that to be part of the narrative, because I know ultimately this is what we really want. It leads to peace of mind. The other stuff does not. It does not. It's a side trip. Very bad side trip. So, I'm an advocate for this narrative. Others are advocates for other narratives. You know, this is how it is right now. And I don't want this narrative to get crushed at all. I'll do everything I can to protect it. I'm not going to lose momentum with this. No way. So whatever needs to be done, whatever safe harbor is necessary, that's what I'll do. And this is what I advocate. So being very adamant, I feel the tipping point is here. I feel a power struggle is imminent. anything could trigger it. If anybody feels somebody else is suddenly gaining a decisive advantage, that's going to trigger all of them. You see, it's going to trigger all of them. This is the trouble we're in. And so it may seem peaceful still, but trouble is potentially imminent. But electricity was just tripped somewhere. Interesting. And these narratives have the ways and means to create a lot of trouble for the world, I'm telling you. More than we realize. More than we realize. So, you know, we'll take adamant steps to prevent backsliding. I've called upon it. We will continue to call upon it. I'm assured of response. It is a heartfelt call. We will not backslide. We are asking for all the help available, all of it, to prevent any and all backsliding here. Okay? We will not backslide. No matter what happens, come what may, we will not backslide. Period. So a fuse just blew, circuit breaker just blew. Very indicative of what's going on, what could go on now in the world, right? But we will not backslide. And we will become more and more adamant about this, more and more adamant about this, more and more adamant about this. The path of managing our success is the path. Okay, and we're doing it, and so we will keep doing it. It's the righteous thing to do, period. It is the righteous thing to do. And we will not be crushed by anything. We will continue. We will continue. In one way or another, we will continue. And we will continue to be adamant advocates for this emphasis, right emphasis in life. Okay, so where are we at in this video? Have we got a good, well, we've reached, we've already reached, yeah, some pretty good stretch here. So I will bring this to a close. I may have to reset that circuit breaker and let this sink in, let this sink in, let this sink in. Let your prayers be for all that have left permanently escape the battlefield. We call upon all to adamantly protect our progress and to not allow any backsliding whatsoever, to provide a safe harbor for us. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.